Hi, it's Dr. A, and in this third video on body organization for medical terminology, we are going to look at things like anatomical position and planes and quadrants and regions, etc. So let's start with the anatomical position. So this gentleman right here reflects the anatomical position. So he is standing erect, so standing up. With arms on the side of the body, but kind of a little bit away from the body. But the most importantly is the palms are facing forward with the thumb up, okay? And most of the time, you know, we're pretty easy on figuring out what's the front of the body, what's the back. So, you know, his face is in the front, anterior, chest is in the front, anterior, not a problem, right? Anterior portion of the legs, easy. Posterior would be, you know, back of the head, the back, buttocks, etc. But we get confused with the arms. So this is where I've seen most students make mistakes on what's anterior and posterior for the arms. So if you refer to the anatomical position, then this is the anterior or the front of the arm, and this is the posterior or the back of the arm. But because we tend to hold the arms oftentimes like this lady right here, a lot of students are confused and think that this is the front, the anterior portion of the arm, and that this is the back or the posterior portion of the arm, and that is not correct. So I just want to make that aware for you that this is the correct anatomical position. I'm also going to make another statement which you may think this is crazy. I've learned my right and left when I was in kindergarten, and I know my right from my left, but it can get confusing. And so I do want to indicate that whenever we're referring to right or left, we always refer to the patient's right or left. And a lot of times the patient is facing you. And so what's on your right's on their left. And so you got to really kind of get that set in your mind that, for example, here, for me, that's right. But this is the patient's left and this is the patient's right. And so when you chart things or, you know, you have to make sure you chart things accordingly and that you get your right and left straight. And it's such a problem and it's so basic that one of the practices has been now for surgery, if you have to have a limb operated on, you actually have to physically with a Sharpie mark which limb it is so that they don't do surgery on the wrong limb, because even surgeons will get their right and left and do surgery, you know, they get the right and left mistaken and do surgery on the wrong limb. So there you go. There's your fair warning about right and left. Okay, so the body planes. So if you slice the body in a certain way, those are the body planes. So the frontal plane or coronal plane goes down through the corona. So think corona, crown, where you would put your crown top of the head. It goes down that way and it divides the body into front and back or anterior and posterior halves. Sagitto means vertical. And so think dividing it vertically. And so the sagittal plane, also known as the median plane, because it goes through the middle of the body, divides the body into right and left. And then trans means across. And so that one goes across the body here and divides it into, or it's horizontal and divides it into top and bottom or inferior and superior halves. So there are two additional sections that may be used to divide the body structures. There's cross section, which is produced by a slice that's perpendicular to the long axis of a structure. So try to think of like slicing a cucumber that's looking at slices and cross sectional imaging. And so that is a lot of the images that we get from CT scans or cross-sectional, right? And then a longitudinal section we produce by a lengthwise slice along the long axis of a structure. Think of slicing a hot dog bun, right? It's long ways, all right? So next we're going to talk about the body regions. So the body is also divided into large regions that are easily to identify externally. So brachial is arms, cephalic is the head, cervical is neck, crural is the legs. So those are pretty easy. In the anterior trunk, the thoracic region is the chest, the abdominal region is the belly or the abdomen, the pelvic region or the pelvis is in your hip bones, if you will, and then the pubic regions is where the genitals are. And the posterior trunk, the dorsum or the back, and then we have the vertebral region where your spinal column is, and the gluteal region or your buttocks or what you sit down on. So here they are illustrated. And so with your root words that are applying to the body regions, so cephalo so for cephalic, cervico for cervical, the neck, thoraco for thoracic, for the chest, brachio for brachial or the arms, abdomino for the abdomen, pelvor for the pelvic area, pubo for the pubic area below the pelvis here, cruro for the legs, and dorso for the back here with vertebral right here, vertebro for the vertebral column, and gluteo for gluteal or the buttocks. The body has many open spaces known as body cavities. There are two dorsal cavities. On the back, we have your cranial cavity that contains the brain and the spinal cavity that contains the spinal cord. There are also two ventral cavities, which can be further subdivided. So you have the thoracic cavity, and it's separated by the other cavity, which is the abdominal pelvic cavity, via the diaphragm. Right, so that separates the thoracic from the abdominal pelvic. Abdominal pelvic is lumped together because it's actually one continuous space between the abdomen and the pelvis. So the thoracic cavity, one of the ventral cavities, can be divided into the lungs, right, on right and left side, and the mediastinum, which is in the middle here underneath the breastbone. So the mediastinum is the space between the lungs, and it has the heart, the aorta, the esophagus, the trachea, and the thymus gland. And then, you know, the lungs have the lungs. And the abdominal pelvic cavity is one of the ventral cavities, and it is separated from the thoracic cavity by the diaphragm. And it is divided into the abdominal, which is the upper part, and then the pelvic, which is the lower part for the cavities. And it contains all the digestive organs, so your stomach, your intestines, your liver, pancreas, your colon, etc. And then your excretory organs, so your kidneys, bladder, ureters, etc. And then your reproductive organs, so for females, your ovaries and uterus, etc. And for the males, a lot of that, I mean, you have your prostate and stuff, but a lot of the rest of it's kind of on the outside. But so here they are illustrated. And so we have the dorsal one, we have cranial and spinal cavity. They're illustrated here in orange. The ventral cavities are in purple. So we have thoracic cavity, but then it's further divided into the pleural cavity, which contains the lungs, the mediastinum area, and the cavity that has the heart is called pericardial. It's in the inferior mediastinum, so the lower mediastinum. And then we have the diaphragm in between, and then we have your abdominal cavity and pelvic cavity, or abdominal pelvic cavity. So the organs and the ventral cavities are referred to as the viscera. Your viscera. If you want to think of something really gross, the medieval times practice of eviscerating somebody, it was cutting them open and all their guts spilling out. Maybe that'll help you remember viscera. So the viscera are contained in a double-layered sac. And the parietal layer of that sac lines the cavities, and the visceral layer makes contact with the viscera. The reason that is that allows for, there's fluid in between, it allows for movement. And so if you think about it, your lungs are expanding and contracting, you have food moving through your digestive system, etc. So all your organs have to have, lining a sac that reduces friction between the organs and as organs move. So in the thoracic cavity, the sac is called the pleural, so the pleura. So then you have the parietal pleura lines the thoracic cavity, the visceral pleura would be right on top of the lungs, okay? And the abdominal pelvic cavity, the sac is called the peritoneum. So then you have parietal peritoneum lines the greater abdominal pelvic cavity, but the visceral peritoneum, then lines the stomach, the intestines, etc. And within the thoracic cavity also, you have the pericardial cavity, and you have also parietal pericardial sac and then visceral pericardial sac. So it also has two layers. So the next topic is the abdominal divisions of the anatomical divisions of the abdomen. Getting ahead of myself here. And so we are going to look at the regions. And there are nine regions. So I feel it's easiest to start in the middle because everybody knows where their belly button is. And that's the umbilical region, where your umbilical cord was, where your belly button is. Okay. So then from that we go epigastric and hypogastric. So it's assuming that the stomach is in this area right here, and kind of right above the umbilical, where the belly button is. So epi means on top of, gastric stomach, epigastric stomach. So that's the area right here, kind of at the bottom of your chest bone, etc., where you might have like heartburn sometimes. So that's the epigastric region. And then hypogastric region is way below that, right on top of the pubic area. Okay. Then we can go right and left. So we have lumbar area, right and left. Lumbar area. The lumbar area is the area of the spine that's flexible, that allows you to flex around like this, which, I mean, the whole spine is flexible. Just that one just has a lot of movement. And then you have right and left iliac. Ilium is for hip bones. So those are where your right and left hip bones are. And then you have right and left hypochondriac. And so like, why it's like below chondro is cartilage, below the cartilage, which you do have a lot of cartilage around your ribs and stuff like that. But one way to think about it is thinking like a hypochondriac is a person that's always sick, and just think of them of like holding their chest and stuff and going, oh, I don't feel good, I'm sick. And so maybe you can, that can help you remember that those two areas, both sides of the epigastric regions, are the right and left hypochondriac regions. And then the quadrants. The quadrants are used a lot in charting. And so they're helpful because they kind of narrow down the location of different organs. So we have four quadrants: the right upper quadrant, the right lower quadrant, the left upper, and the left lower. And then if you are to chart, or if somebody comes in and having some pain, you could indicate, let's say they're having gallbladder issues and their pain is up here, then you would indicate on your charting that they have right upper quadrant pain. And so if they have right upper quadrant pain, then automatically we can think it could be something with the liver, because the majority of the liver is in that quadrant, potentially your right kidney, part of the colon, a small portion of the pancreas, the gallbladder is there, and then some portion of the small intestines. Now, I am going to note, as you can tell here, the small intestines are in all four quadrants, and so is the colon. Okay. So, you know, it could be colon pain in a right upper quadrant and not be gallbladder if they had an ulcer in this location in their colon or something like that. Okay. The right lower quadrant is helpful because right here is where your appendix is. And so a right lower quadrant pain could be appendicitis, could be the appendix, but could also, if you're female, be where you, that's where your right ovary is and your right fallopian tube. So if you're having some female problems, that could cause you on the right side, that could cause you right lower quadrant pain. You also have the right ureter that's leading from the right kidney to the bladder. Now, the bladder is a midline structure, so it's right down in the middle, so it's not really in either quadrant. And the uterus is also a midline structure, and so is the prostate for the males. Now, if you had left upper quadrant pain, then even though there's a small portion of the liver, there's a large portion of the stomach in that area. So maybe they have a stomach ulcer or some stomach problems. Still have the colon and small intestine. A big chunk of the pancreas is going to be over here too in that left upper quadrant. So maybe they have pancreatitis, okay? And then the left lower quadrant, other than having a colon and small intestines, will have the left ureter, to left ovary and the left fallopian tube for females. All right, and that wraps up this video, and I will see you in the next.